that can be seen in a lot of films. It is also a preferred location for many people who live in California, for surfing, scuba diving, or all kinds of water activities. Plus, you can see it's incredibly beautiful.
California and Los Angeles have managed to attract artists from all over the world who have come here to find their place in the biggest scenes and potential for their opportunities. In this episode of Cinema Confidential, we'll introduce you to a few professionals who combine many different talents: music, acting, stage presence, and have settled in Los Angeles after finding possibilities for all these. Steve Cooke is a musician, an actor, and an artist who has done musical theater and has experience on the small screen. Originally from New Zealand, Steve has lived in Europe and more than 10 years ago headed to Los Angeles, where he keeps making music today, both as a successful stage performer and a studio musician.
I know that your father is a musician. Yes. Was that the reason why you became so interested in music? I think it was. I remember I was quite a charming and efficient young roadie so I used to carry the microphones for my father while I was setting up the entire band. And the other half of my family is very academic. They're all like lawyers and doctors and business people, and they were all like, you know, you don't want to be doing that music stuff, you know, get a real job. And
yeah.
So when I was 17, I wrote a song called Traveling Man. And the lyrics are, you know, I left home when I was just 17, a little in love with the rock and roll dream. I packed my bag and picked up my guitar and said, hey, Ma, one day I'm going to be a star. So I published that song, and surprisingly, it did really well.
Wow.
And that was the beginning of my career. A friend of mine came and picked me up. You know, I left home, and we lived in a house and just played music all day long, every day, for weeks. And then we got together a whole body of work, and I was this young man touring over New Zealand and Australia. I had my first release on Radio Windy in Wellington, and John Barry, he discovered us. We were in a band at the time called The Pilgrims. And we were fortunate enough to double bill with some quite well-known acts at the time. So, you know, we did that for a few years, and it just sort of grew from there. And I always had a passion to go to England, because my father being British.
Yeah.
So I wanted to take the entire band to London, and we all got paid off, and I bought an aeroplane ticket, and the other members of the band bought new Marshall amplifiers, new guitars, and I was like, oh, we're off to London. And they were like, oh no, Steve, we're gonna stay here. So I went on my own, yes.
Okay, and then what happened? How old were you at that
time? I was probably 19.
Okay.
When I went to London. I went there first on my own at a place called The Lion in down in Bradford. And then I had another place I played called The Orange Tree in Richmond.
I studied in Richmond. I used to live in Richmond. London.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, if you're at the Richmond station, you come out of the station and opposite is the Orange Tree pub.
Yes, I know that pub.
And that's, yeah, and that's where The Who originally played in. And I was totally fascinated. I was very fortunate with England. A little bit of the pub culture. I played at another pub in Richmond where I met the original drummer from Jimi Hendrix's band, Mitch Mitchell.
Were you able to support yourself only with music back then?
No, it was pretty hard. I found myself doing landscaping as well. You know, it's the music is feast and famine.
Yeah.
You know, like when you're touring and the times are good, you know, you have a lot and you think that's going to last forever. So you keep spending,
yeah.
You know,
yeah.
And then suddenly it's the end of the tour. You know, something goes wrong and then you're like, well, where's the next gig?
And now you are on a show on Netflix.
Yes, yes, I am.
A musician.
For my sins, yes. I'm I'm playing Paul McCartney's guitarist.
How is that?
Dusty Lane.
How is that?
Oh, that was great fun. That was really, that was wonderful. When I first got the script, it had a part written in it for Ringo Starr. And I thought, wow, you know, this is it. I've cracked it now. You know, it's all been worthwhile. And unfortunately, Ringo couldn't make the filming.
Led Zeppelin Experience.
And if the sun refused to shine, I would still be loving you.
Well, you also have a very, let's call it, special relationship with Led Zeppelin.
Yes, that was very interesting how that came about.
How did it come about?
Well, we were doing a lot of music that we'd written, a lot of original material. And in 1992 in the UK, there was a terrible recession. Margaret Thatcher was in power, and this gentleman I met from the band Simple Minds, Malcolm Foster, he said, look, Cookie, it's the 25th anniversary of Led Zeppelin. Shall we have a go at playing some of their music? So I said, yeah, okay, why not? You know, when I was growing up with rock and roll with my dad, it was always, you know, Eric Clapton and the Stones and Deep Purple, and you know, there wasn't so much Zeppelin in the house,
yeah,
as a child. So I wasn't really a Zepp head per se, but because I'd done all of this acting, he was more or less saying, you know, this is a role you need to play. When we did lots of gigs and that, and then we did the big gig at the end of it, because we all agreed to only do it for that 25th anniversary year. So our last show was at the Empire in Leicester Square in London. And as fate would have it, Mr. Robert Plant himself came, and he brought with him another singer, a guy called Noddy Holder from a great English band called Slade.
Mm-hmm.
So the room was actually full and it holds a tremendous amount of people. We had like 200 VIPs up on the top part of the Empire there. And of course, Robert Plant and Noddy Holder were viewing the performance from up there with all the other, you know, wonderful guests that we had. And then the public were down on the floor and we just reproduced it and ended the whole thing on a high. And that was the last show, you know. My father lives in Christchurch, New Zealand, where they've had that terrible massacre.
Oh God, yes.
And I was just thinking about the people there and the people all over the world. And I'm just working on this at the moment, so you have to bear with me here. It goes a little bit like this. So much that we got tired of thinking about it. We got so much love, we gotta let some out. But lately now we don't see eye to eye. The last thing we wanna do is break down and cry. Don't want to
see you cry. See you cry. I wanna see you cry. So let those hard times become the good times. I keep moving on. Let those feelings of love shine brighter, warmer than the sun. Warmer than the sun.
See what?
Fernando Allende is an actor and one of the biggest Latin American music stars. After many telenovelas, films, albums, and television projects, he has proven that he can do it all. Recently, a new reality show started that follows Fernando and his entire family, his wife Marie, his sons Adan and Elena, as well as their daughter-in-law Jenny, in their everyday life. A part of the family welcomes us to their home to tell us all about the project Mexican Dynasties and about the life of the Allende family.
Welcome home.
Adan.
Welcome.
Hello. Fernando, Marie, and Nacho.
Nacho's here.
Nacho also has a showbiz career, so.
Yes, indeed, and a romantic career too.
Yes.
Yeah.
I know all about his marriage.
Well, which one of them?
The one with Chloe.
Oh, with Chloe. Yeah. You know that one. Unfortunately, you know that marriage had to be annulled by the Vatican. You know, it was never consummated. So, so we're still looking for a girlfriend for Nacho. Okay, I'm going to be, in the next 2 years, I'm going to be a half a century in the industry. I started when I was 18 years of age, and so far I've done 54 feature films, playing leading roles, and I've done 18 albums, and probably 3,000 hours of television. Because, you know, I used to do a lot of novellas that were very popular and very, very popular. And I just delivered my 18th album with Universal Music very successfully. The first single was Tombola that our people can watch and listen to because we are in every single platform. Tombola. And I had the pleasure to sing this song also with 152 participants to Miss World. And we did this in China, where I was for the fourth time the MC. We've always been very, very precautious in showing the right side. And that's the reason that we put all this cooperation together to create Mexican Dynasties, because we felt that it was necessary at this time to have a more ample image of who we are as a community, as a society. So the other thing I want to say is that we're very lucky for the first time in history to be in primetime international television with an all-Hispanic cast. This has never, ever happened in history, and it's happening today.
Marie, I wanted to ask you, when did you and how did you meet Fernando? And what did you know about him when you met him for the first time?
When I met him, well, actually, I had no clue about him. Except through my best friend Sonia Stegui Chardon, which was my best friend since we were 4 years old in preschool. And she was Miss Puerto Rico, Miss Tourism of Las Americas, and Miss Pan America 1975. And when she was, you know, giving the crown to the next queen, she wanted Fernando to be her date. He was doing a novella and he did not arrive. And I used to tell her, why do you want an artist? Get an investment banker. In the meantime, a friend of ours, he wanted to introduce me to Fernando because he was managing him. But at that time, I was already living in London. I wanted an investment banker.
Oh God.
And
me too.
Anyway, I was in the process of moving London, New Orleans, consolidating and just staying in Aspen, Colorado for good, which I did. And that was May 85 when I met Fernando in Puerto Rico.
I never realized it took so long to know each other, to meet each other.
11 years.
Wow.
11 years.
Yeah, well, it was
when things are meant to be.
Because they're meant to be. I'm back from Canada. I was shooting The Hitchhiker with Karen Black, rest in peace. And as you know, they're bringing my suitcases and I'm opening the door, I already hear the phone ringing. And I say, oh, I'm gonna pick it up. Yeah, okay, give me the, come in. So I went.
213-271-4030 was your private number.
You got that right. You still have it. So I walk in, you know, pick up the phone, it's Mari. And she's telling me that she's in Aspen. And I say, okay, so what's the day, the 10th? How about Valentine's for me to arrive in Aspen? And she says, sounds good. And I say, sounds really good. So people that know me, you know, they know that I like to play, you know, pranks and things.
But this is the third time I'm gonna see him in my life.
Yeah. So I allow all the people, I saw her through the window and she was there with balloons.
Balloon bouquet.
With hearts.
With helium balloons, red helium balloons with hearts.
And then, you know, all the passengers left the plane and I'm waiting for the captain to tell the captain, tell her that there's nobody else on board. I said, but I'm just playing a prank to my girlfriend, so tell her that.
She was already my girlfriend. We had never kissed, we had never held hands.
It doesn't matter, you were my girlfriend already. So the captain went down there, and I see them through the window, you know, that she's like, and she's like, So she turned around, and that moment, I rushed out of the plane. I'm here. So then we hugged, and I believe that we hugged, right? Did we kiss?
We finally touched each other. We kiss here and here.
So, how do you feel hearing that story?
Oh, it's always entertaining. They've told it like 100 times, but every time I hear it, it's like the first time. They're such raconteurs. I love them. You know, it's funny you say that because, like, I grew up in the business, I grew up on the sets, I grew up in the recording studios. It was part of my life. I traveled with them, I still travel with them now, but going back to that moment when I was a kid, I graduated high school at 18 years old. My first film was when I was 10, so there was kind of like a time where I'm like, oh, I'm living a normal life. My dad left Hollywood because he wanted his kids to have a normal life, even though my mom told me that we had some journalists taking pictures in our property. College, I studied communications. I passed a semester. Then I said, I'm going to try something different. I'm going to go study marketing. So I studied marketing. Very interesting. I learned a lot of stuff. And then I said, now I'm going to study, because I wasn't totally comfortable. You know, something was always itching inside of me for something more. And at this point, I'm like playing guitar, surfing, hanging out with all my friends, skateboarding, and music had always been a part of my life, and I loved to dance since I was a little kid. I was always on the floor dancing. But I was in class one day, and I was in video game design school, and I'm sitting down on the computer, air conditioning, must be like 3 p.m., like everybody's like super talented, everybody's good at drawing, and I'm there, and then the teacher starts putting on a song. He says, I'm gonna put on some music if that's okay with you guys. And he puts on Katy Perry, California Girls, and I like, dun. Dun, dun, dun. And I look, dun, 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 dun. And at this point, I get up from my chair and I said, I am meant to be on a stage.
Wow.
And I go running home and I drive. I get out of my car and I go running up to my mom and dad. I'm like, Mom, Dad, I want to be like you guys. I want to be in entertainment.
I said, welcome home, son.
I never pushed for either kid to be in the entertainment industry. Elan was born and raised in Aspen as well. When he was 13 and Adan was 10, we moved to Puerto Rico for 9 years. Mm-hmm. And during his time in Puerto Rico, he met Jennifer Colon Alvarado, which in 2009, when Fernando was the Master of Ceremonies, the host for Miss World Puerto Rico, Jennifer was chosen, and Fernando says, this is the one. He told all the judges, check her out and check her out and check her out. You know, do whatever
I said this to the judges because she was the one that had it all.
She
had it all.
Had it all. And we had a club, and we had loaned the club to the Miss World organization. And Elan was the manager of the club. He was almost finishing college, and he met Jenny. And Jenny was getting married to someone else. They became friends. Elan says, I want to go back to Puerto Rico for my birthday. And I go, really? Little did we know that it was that Jenny had told him she had split with a boyfriend. She was not getting married. And Elan and Jenny, Elan arrives for his birthday, September 15th. And on September 21st, they got married. So you have a few more years to party and have fun.
A few more years? Many years.
You will know when she arrives, you will know, as much as I did know, that your mom was going to be with me for the rest of my life.
Oh.
So.
Oh.
Gracias a ustedes. Hasta pronto. Gracias. Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Thank you for coming.